double blotch, the kind of meat in the middle. It's almost like the number 8, and it's just to the left of that small Sea of Crises. The one on the top is the famous Mare Tranquillitatis, the Sea of Tranquility. Duncan knows all this. I'm just telling the listeners here. And the one below it is the Sea of Serenity. Serenity, Tranquility, Crises, see? Emotions, that's what we're looking at. And the Apollo, of course, the Apollo 11 was on that upper one, the Sea of Tranquility.
It's interesting you should say that, Bob, because the chap who wrote the music for our film In the Shadow of the Moon, Philip Shepherd, I asked him, where did you get your sort of inspiration from? And obviously, he draws on lots of different things, but one of the things he mentioned to me was, well, I looked at the names of the Mare, and I just thought they were really emotive and depicted human emotion, and I drew some inspiration from those names.
Left side of the moon is more is kind of a less well defined. There's more blotches there, and on the extreme left, the kind of the darkest part we're seeing is Oceanus. You'll see another one of the watery themes in Procellarum, if that's how it's pronounced. Never was sure about that one, and I don't know what that one means. I wonder if Duncan does. Or Procellarum. Oceanus, Procellarum. That's the dark blotch on the extreme left. I mean, we know what Tranquility and Serenity and Crises, what all of those are. In fact, the blotch on the lower right is Mare Nectaris, a sea of nectars. That's kind of pretty. But Procellarum, what's that? I mean, were you forced to take Latin in school, Duncan?
No, unfortunately not. And it's a shame, really, because funnily enough, for a lot of the things that I've studied when I was at university, of course, the nomenclature comes from Greek and Latin, and it was interesting because my father had to do it. This was, you know, way back when. And so I would say a name to him, a geological name, for example, like pyroclastic, which is basically something that's thrown out of a volcano. It's called a pyroclastic. Well, pyro means fire and clastic means broken fire. And he could deduce that, you see. And I thought that was really smart. So it's definitely something that I think would have helped me, but you pick it up as you go along, I guess. Oh, well, you pick up some of it.
That's right. We were not like those of us in the physical sciences. We were not like the medical people who were forced to into more Latin than we were.
Yeah.
It's a shame. I watched Jeopardy, and most of the Shakespearean plays, I tell myself, oh, I should know this better. This is terrible. I'm a writer, you know. So, in any case, this is our
thing about the moon is it's always there. You know, it's always like it's almost comforting to sort of watch its phases and see it wax and wane. And I've always been intrigued by that. It's almost it's a great measure of time. It's some sort of degree of stability, I think. And I think you were mentioning earlier about previous civilizations, and you can understand how they became comforted and in fact based their well I mean a lot of their lives around the moon. And it always amazes me at just how skilled a lot of previous societies were in being able to predict lunar eclipses and predict the phase of the moon and use it as a calendar and use it to indicate various aspects of their lives. And in fact it's permeated through the sort of fabric of society today. There are so many terms and parts of our lives that still revolve around this lunar phase. But I guess for me, I really got to know the moon when we were working within the shadow of the moon, and we got to meet those people who I always sort of think it's one of the most elite clubs in the world, if not the most elite club, which is the surviving astronauts who walked on its surface.
That's
and
right. Nine are surviving.
That's
right.
Yeah. Exactly.
I mean, they're getting on there now. They're in their 80s,
well, they
aren't they?
They are. Okay. They are in their 80s. Now, I would have met them when they were a little bit younger, sort of late 70s, but still incredibly sharp, very lucid, wonderful stories to tell.
And interesting, too, as you've brought out, mm-hmm. how the moon has changed each of them, how being on the moon has in very different ways.
Yes, that was really interesting, because I think thinking about it, and each one, they're a very eclectic group of people, obviously a very, very intelligent bunch of people, and they have a commonality with regards to their training, but each one of them, from my experience of the ones that I met and had the opportunity to talk to, are very individual. And Alan, you mentioned Alan Bean, who flew on Apollo 12, is an artist and a painter. Charlie has a deep faith, and
that's Charlie Deke, right?
Yeah, it's Charlie Duke, who flew mm-hmm. on Apollo 16. But what I thought was interesting is it seems to me that once you've gone to the moon and you've returned, how do you top that? And it seems to me that traits that they had, I don't want to speak for them, but traits that they had before they went to the moon, i.e. an interest in faith or art or whatever it may be, was magnified by the experience. So coming back, they decided, you know, I mean, perhaps they wanted to spend more time and pursue the things that they'd always been interested in. But a very interesting bunch of people with, if you think about it, a really amazing experience. I mean, it's a bit shameful, but I always used to look at their feet, and I used to think, those feet, you know, they've left footprints on the surface of the moon that are going to be there for millions of years, because there's very little erosion on the moon, there's no wind, there's no water. So any footprint that you leave on the lunar surface in that very fine powdery soil that you were talking about earlier, Bob, you know, it's going to be there for such a long period of time. And if we ever go back to the moon, and I'm sure we will, it's just a matter of time, those places will probably become sites of scientific interest and maybe even museums. But those footprints will always be there. And it
yes.
was interesting to meet the people who, the very, very top of the pyramid, those were the people who actually got to lay those footprints. And as you mentioned earlier, you know, sort of 400,000 people who worked very, very hard for a long period of time to make it happen.
And as I, although you didn't mention it in the movie, in that very fine movie of yours, I understand that the astronaut who left a photograph of his kids, of his family on the surface, the others regretted not doing that too.
Yeah, that was Charlie. Charlie Duke. In fact, I think we have the picture in the film, but I can't quite remember now because I've seen that picture so many times. But a lovely gesture. I know he took in his flight plan there were notes from his kids as he was traveling out scale. And I think that's a wonderful shines a very bright light on how quickly technology propulses us forward, pushes us forward, propels us forward.
Quite so. I wonder how that photograph is going to endure. We're going to have our next guest, by the way, in another 40 or 45 minutes from now, is going to be Dr. Lucy Green, also a Brit and also an astronomer, professional astronomer. Her field is the sun, and she's going to talk about how the sun's intense bombardment with its electromagnetic radiation and its particles have changed the surface of the moon that we're looking at. So I would think, Duncan, that it's going to pretty much mess up those photographs before too terribly long. But
I don't think that photograph lasted very long at all. In fact, I think it was a matter of minutes before it had curled because of the surface temperature there. So I think I'm right in Charlie telling us that it was there for just a fleeting moment.
Mm. But it is interesting, going back to what you were talking about, how different the different astronauts were. Buzz Aldrin made no secret of the fact that he could not live up to the fame and had problems with alcohol, checked himself into a mental hospital. He had a lot of problems after his time on the moon. Neil Armstrong simply became a recluse. Others turned to religion. Edgar Mitchell became arguably the wackiest of them all and got into psychic phenomena.
Well, I think this is the point I'm trying to make. I think to us it may look a bit weird and wacky, but I don't think actually it was. I think all of them had these interests before they went to the moon, but the experience, I think, magnified their interests. And you know, I think sometimes they get a bit of a raw deal from my perspective, because obviously, you know, going to the moon is going to change your life, but it was an area that perhaps they didn't have any training in. They trained just about for every other eventuality, but to train for that kind of fame was perhaps something that was overlooked and would naturally be something that's quite difficult to come to terms with, because they haven't changed, but the way we perceive them changed, and changed radically, and changed overnight. And so from their perspective, nothing's different. But for us, you know, these men have gone to the moon. I mean,
well, except some of them were